us in worship as well. Everyone got a chance to remember their baptism this morning, right? So getting a little rain on you, but you know that is good for the earth. Let's see, we have flowers today, courtesy of Marta Bauer on her birthday, so thank you, Marta. She's back out handing communion cups to people, so working on her birthday, I guess. And so, thank you for those beautiful flowers. Also, I just want to say, we don't always get a chance to do this, but two of our church members got married yesterday. And I'm not going to embarrass them too much, but they're sitting in the back row. So, Brian and Debbie, congratulations. Here they are. We're starting to collect for Lutheran World Relief School Kits. So now's the time of year. The school supplies are on sale, so watch the ads and check that list for the types of supplies that we are needing to send out. And we thank you for participating in that important ministry. Busy week this week. We have a worship meeting on Monday night. We have a fall planning meeting on Tuesday with youth, social ed, social ministry, and adult ed all together. So if you are part of any of those teams, please make a note of that. And then looking ahead, at the end of the month, August 28th, same day, we will be at the Cherry Hill Park Pavilion for outdoor worship and to kick off our fall year. And the 21st is Backpack Blessing Sunday, so make note of that for our families as well. And anyone going on farther to some sort of graduate degree, you know, a professional degree. When I started seminary, I went up with my backpack and got it blessed. So please consider doing that too for those of you in continuing on in your education. So this week is the week Camp Noah is happening. Don't know if you guys got a chance to see this, but this was in the paper this week, so kind of sharing a little bit more about the story and the purpose of Camp Noah. And so we are excited that tomorrow around 8:30, 40-some kids will be descending on Gloria Dei, and we'll be checking them in and getting them ready to go through the program of Camp Noah. And which is near and dear to our hearts because of the way that the derecho came through and affected our community. So we are so grateful that we get to be hosts of this event and also be part of the ministry of the event. So and you might hear a little more about that in our sermon. So I invite you then to stand as you are able. We'll begin worship with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God whose steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess
that we have not followed your path that has chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us from what our enemies. Amen.
Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen.
first lesson is from the 15th chapter of Genesis, God's promise of a child for Abram and Sarai. Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 6. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward the heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. And then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. This is the word of the Lord. The second lesson is from the 11th chapter of Hebrews, a model for us, Abraham's faith in a new home given by God. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 3, and verses 8 through 16. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith, our ancestors received approval. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, and their heirs were of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith he received the power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as death, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven, and as the innumerable grains of the sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth. For people who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they left behind, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. This is the word of the Lord.
Truly, I tell you, he will fasten his belt and
and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You must also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord.
Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God. So what is seen was made from things that are not visible. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. I'll let that sink in a little bit. And then I want to start and share a little bit more about the story of Camp Noah coming to Gloria Dei. It began actually while I was on sabbatical. An email was sent out from the organizers of Camp Noah to all the ELCA churches in our Cedar Rapids area. And I'll admit, I wasn't supposed to be looking at my email, but I did see it. I did cheat once in a while and take a peek to see if there was anything that had to be forwarded to someone else. And I saw my colleagues in other churches and saw their response to that, and they were excited about it. And then when I returned from sabbatical, of course it was Holy Week and Easter and everything was a bit of a flurry, but when I got a chance to learn more about Camp Noah, what was said by some fellow ministers here in our community was that we think Gloria Dei is the best place to host that camp. When they talk about the things that they need for the children, your building is just right and your location is perfect. You have the space and you have green space, a place where the kids can go outside in our yard, but also very closely to Cherry Hill Park. So they wanted us to agree to be the location. But all of us working in partnership together, ourselves, First Lutheran, St. Stephen's, our Savior, we all joined in these planning meetings, talking about what it would take. There can be 50 kids enrolled total. That's the cap that they have for running the camp. But that would take somewhere between 25 and 30 volunteers. And the total cost for the camp was $25,500. And that meant some fundraising, and it meant looking for volunteers. This could be a very intimidating idea at this time in our lives. The church has come back from a couple years of being away from each other, and things don't quite work the way they used to. People have been through a lot, they're tired, and people aren't volunteering in the way that they used to. This could be a scary proposition to invite 50 kids to a party and then not have anyone to help lead them through the learning process. So with four churches together, that seemed like, okay, no problem. We can totally do this. And we had members here in our leadership, because our council had to take a look at everything and agree that we would be the host location. And there were a few concerns and questions, which were all necessary and needed to be asked. But I think underneath it all, the question was always, should we really agree to this? Can we really pull it off? Seems like a really big undertaking. And lately the church feels small. Well, from Lutheran Services in Minnesota. It was originally formed as a way to help children build resiliency and to bounce back from the trauma of a disaster. And so this camp has gone all over the country. It was there after Hurricane Katrina. It was here in Cedar Rapids after the flood. First Lutheran hosted that camp. And so there's history with our state and it coming, and they were here from Marshalltown after the tornadoes just a few years back. So there's history, but then also for us, right? Because we know that this sanctuary was down to rafters, right? Rafters and studs. There was a hole in our roof from a tree and from the wind, and there was water damage and all sorts of things that happened that kept us out of our building for almost a year. We watched our neighbors continue to struggle through repairing their homes. Our kids' schools were damaged. They didn't get to go back to school right away. So even though it seems like it was a long time ago, we know that we're continuing to live on with these, with the after effects of that experience. And with the fact that so many children have signed up, and with the stories that some of the parents are sharing with us, it's very clear that this is still something that our community definitely needs. It's also beautiful because it falls this week. Everybody's doing retrospectives, looking back the anniversary of the derecho. It is on the 10th this week. So we kept moving forward, despite the fear that this might be too much, too big, and we might be too small. And then someone from Gloria Dei stepped up, Shannon Johnston, said she would be the site director. She knows the building, she knows the church, she knows the area. She was ready to take that on, to be here all week of Camp Noah for that. Well, then I reached out to one of our members, Rhiannon, who is a retired school counselor, because there's a mental health professional required to be here all week with the kids. And I thought she might be interested in volunteering for that. Well, she wasn't able to. She had some scheduling reasons, but she hooked me up with someone who had just retired from Viola Gibson as their counselor and was ready to embark on this adventure with us. Well, there's two things we ticked off the list, right? We still needed a team leader to organize the volunteers, and we also needed the money. Well, I talked with some of my colleagues, and St. Stephen's immediately promised $2,000 towards the cause. All the congregations were going to offer funds toward it, and then we would be looking for outside grants and resources. And the question came up, well, would LSI, Lutheran Services in Iowa, have some funds for this? So we made a call. And not only did they have some funds, but they came back and they said, we'd like to sponsor and fund the entire thing. And we have some additional money. So if you can think of a way to use that additional money, let us know. And so now we have kids coming and traveling from different parts of Cedar Rapids that are going to get picked up on a little charter bus and get driven here to go to camp. So we went from, is this too much and are we too little, to two main volunteers that we needed and $30,000 to support the camp. So First Lutheran, one of their members, is going to run the kitchen. They had their Saturday evening meal program. And so they have connections with local food banks and that to get some food. So they got some funds, they got some food donated to feed the kids. They get a snack, they get two snacks, lunch and breakfast while they're here. So then we have that. organization and the extra food, plus then it was determined that St. Stephen's funds that were already committed would be also for our food expenses. And then we still didn't have a team leader. Now this gets tricky because we're trying to coordinate volunteers, but we don't have somebody who's specifically coordinating them. So we were working on inviting people to be part of the camp, but we didn't have one person that was kind of the go-to for the whole thing. So in a meeting, one of the Synod representatives was there, and I said, don't we have any seminarians? Don't we have anybody who's just graduated who doesn't have a church yet? Is there anybody I can call? And Val from the Synod office said, well, there's Britt. I said, Britt? I said, does she have long dark hair and is really, you know, energetic? Oh, yeah, that's her. Well, I just met her at Synod Assembly a few weeks prior. We were standing at lunch in line waiting for lunch, and you know, I'm so shy that, and so is she, if you met her last Sunday, we struck up a conversation. So I had already met her. She had the energy and the wherewithal, and I called her and I said, hey, we met at Synod Assembly. Want to come and help us run a camp for 50 kids? And she said, sure, yeah, sign me up. Do you need to know anything more? Yeah. No, you'll tell me. So there she was. Well, then the news story happened. That is also thanks to First Lutheran. One of their members' daughter is a meteorologist there. And so she helped kind of fuel the news release and push it through to the right people. So then we got to be on KCRG. We got to spread the story. And then the registrations from the kids start going through the roof. So now we're like, okay. Now what we need though is those 25 to 30 people. And they were trickling in. We were finding different people to fill in different roles. And I think this was really one of the things that we were most worried about, more than money. Right? When we say this is too big and we're too small, where are these people going to come from? And yes, there are a few other churches, and some of our key volunteers have come from those places, but I want to tell you that the majority of our volunteers are from Gloria Dei. And I want to thank you for that, but I want to point out that we're continuing to keep going on doing things in the midst of change. And not by our own power. I don't give us credit. This isn't a huge pat on the back to Gloria Dei, although you are awesome. But this is a credit to our God. Right? This is too big. We are too small, but God is bigger than all of that. The abundance of God is being proven time and time again throughout this story of Camp Noah coming here to Gloria Dei. So have no fear. It's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. This is our invitation to be participating in the kingdom and then be introducing it or inviting others into it as well. It's not an imposition to invite someone into something that is joy-filled and life-giving. It's a privilege to be part of God's work in the world. It's our calling. Everyone's tired. I'm tired. But when we find these things that are just sort of infectious and contagious, not in a way we have to wear masks, but in a way that fills us up, that sparks our energy, that makes us say, yeah, whatever, I'm in. Let's go. It's for kids. It's a camp. It's fun. It's going to teach them hope, resilience. We're all in. This isn't a have to. This isn't something we have to do. It's something we get to do. We're not called to save what we have known as the institutional church. We're called that with these words, these promises from God in the scripture that we heard today. That faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not seen. The beginning of the story, we couldn't see. Well, we could see, we could imagine what Camp Noah would look like. We hoped, but we had no idea where all these different components were going to come from. And they came, little by little by little by little. Like Abram saying to God, well, I just have to make Eliezer my heir, because where's my heir coming from? And all the volunteers and the money and the kids and the story getting shared, the funds, the resources, all of that came into place. So do not be afraid, little flock. And by that, little, that's a term of endearment, right? It's like Jesus saying, do not be afraid, dear flock. Not that we're little. For it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. You must be ready. The Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. Let's be ready for whatever the Holy Spirit is bringing our way, so that we get to share this hope that we have been given with the world. Let your loving kindness be upon your church, the church that is your people. Fill all who proclaim the gospel with the power of your Holy Spirit, and equip your flock to speak your word of promise and hope in the midst of fear and uncertainty. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Let your loving kindness be upon your creation. Dwell among us and sustain our earthly home. In places of famine, provide nourishment. In places of plenty, fashion us to be good stewards of your bounty. Lord, in your mercy. Let your loving kindness be upon your world. Be our helper and our shield in places torn by strife and violence. Raise up courageous leaders to govern with compassion and justice. Lord, in your mercy. Let your loving kindness be upon your children. Look upon all who wait for your steadfast love. Console those who grieve and embrace those who cry out to you. We lift before you on the stretchers of our prayers all those for whom prayer has been requested through our Gloria Dei prayer chain, and all those we name before you now, silently or loud. Help us trust your promise and not be afraid. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray for the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America and its members who will gather this week in its churchwide assembly. Inspire the celebration of God's varied works throughout the church. Instill your peace in the midst of the work you have called us to and the deliberations that will take place. Shape the work of the church according to your will for the whole world. Lord, in your mercy. For those traveling to the assembly, you kept Abraham and Sarah in safety throughout the days of their pilgrimage. You led the children of Israel through the midst of the sea, and by a start, you led the Magi to, by a star, you led the Magi to the infant Jesus. Protect and guide all those traveling now as they set out. Make the way safe and the homecoming is joyful. And bring us all at last to our heavenly home, where you dwell in glory with our Lord Jesus Christ. Pray for the safe travel of our member Marta, who is going to vote at churchwide assembly. Lord, your mercy. Let your loving kindness be upon this community. Fashion our hearts to strive for the way of peace. Strengthen the outreach ministries of this congregation. Be with every child and family who are taking part of Camp Noah. Thank you for the love that and commitment that is flowing out of those who have volunteered to be part of the work of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. With thanksgiving, we remember all who have died in the faith and now rest in you. As they place their hope in you, so strengthen us to trust in your promise of new life. Lord, in your mercy. Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, our holy wisdom. Amen. Join together in the offering prayer. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field, and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, we took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray with confidence the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. For those who have your communion cups with you in the pew, I invite you now to peel back the seal over the bread, and taste and see that God is good, and to know that this is the body of Christ given for you. And then you do the same over the juice or the wine. Pull back the seal, and as you drink, taste and see that God is good, and know that this is the blood of Christ shed for you. Through this meal you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.